By the way, this is a June, okay? You can register yourself. It's very, it's a free software. You can easily learn. There is options. For example, you know, simply you have a start video and then a record video. You have a voice mic. So be sure to have your camera and a mic. Then you will have your PowerPoint file on your screen like this. And then whatever you say, whatever you do, and whatever you speak will be recorded. And that will be converted as, after a meeting, convert into a MP3 file. And then you just simply upload to YouTube. Yes, so you have to select a share screen. You can record many desktop or some specific window. You have to select which screen you want to share or you want to record. That's all. One step you need to do. And after you log in, let's say one group, you will have five members and you are all members will appear. You don't have all video camera, at least those who present can have a camera. But main point is that your PowerPoint, and this is the one you record. And YouTube, this is last year's, but this year all the classes been uploaded, so you can you don't have to go to a Google Drive. You can watch it from here. Okay, I mean our record. So all the classes. This is a long time ago. Let you know. This is say this is the one this year, and you can easily search our video. Okay, so you can review anytime you like to do.
On-class, in-class, and online class are recorded and uploaded to our channel.
Okay. Now today, I'd like to go cover the torsion. We've been through equilibrium and some definition of the strain and stress. And then two more chapters which we need to review is the shaft and beam. And after that, we will mainly go to main chapters, which is about all the advanced torsions and bending and energy method and buckling and so on. Okay, so we are still reviewing what we have done last semester. So chapter 8 and shaft and torsions. We will have some time for your questions on your task, your homework. Okay, this is chapter 8, shaft and torsions. And shaft, as I explained many times, is a shaft is a one-dimensional structures. Geometrical wise, the same as others, one-dimensional structures. But the reason the one-dimensional structure is called shaft is that structures support a torsional load. Okay, and this in shaft and torsion, these one-dimensional structures will have a very special cross-section, which is a circular. Only we will cover the circular cross-section in these chapters. But again, even in this chapter, this usual Allen-Ellis flow, flow chart will equally apply to this shaft and torsion theory. Again, force will be the torque and material properties. In this case, the shear modulus, because all the torsion behavior is by the shear stiffness, not the tension mode, always shear. So material property we need is the shear modulus, and deformation is a shear deformations. And inside the material, we certainly have equilibrium and stress and stiffness and strain and deformation conditions. And the stress will be, again, shear stress, and has to be less than shear strength as a design. Okay. very important step in this case in this portion is that we start with deformation conditions. Why? Because stress is always a sixth component in a body, which can be very complicated and is very difficult to solve from the equilibrium conditions. So in structural ways, approximation always start with deformation condition. So it's important to remember that we start with assuming displacement. Okay, say this shaft under torsions or deformation will have a certain types of deformation we assume as a function of some coordinate and length, and then we since we have a strain deformation and stress definition and equilibrium, okay, from bottom to top approach is important to know that. Again, as shown here, I'm going to use just this one. And the shaft, let's say, fixed one point, and then it's subject to a torsion T, and this is the length L, and this is the diameter. As I mentioned, we will mainly only consider the circular. Well, it could be a solid and could be some hollow. It is okay as long as they are all circular cross sections. Okay, can be a solid or can be hollow or sharp is okay. Now, subject to talk T and these cross section will give us the polar moment of inertia, IP. That the definition is important. We will go through and then we will have it. So this is the problem statement. Okay. Say we have a polar moment of inertia and length L and torque T. Now what we like to do to calculate is how much how much angle it twists. It will twist some angle, and how much the stress as a function of R. Those are two quantities we like to find. Okay. And deformations, I will go into detail about this definition. U theta is a function of R and Z. Theta is the, say, any point here is a displacement. U theta is a function of R and function of Z. Z is the this coordinate. And function of R is obvious because all the displacement will increase along the R, and theta is if we look at from bottom to top, I will draw like this, and this will be the coordinate Z, and this U theta is the only one we is important displacement, and the displacement wise it is fixed here, and then increase like that. And this is the angle, okay? This is the angle. And in terms of displacement component, theta directional displacement is proportional to R and proportional to Z. Now there is the proportional coefficient C, which we don't know yet, but it's important to start with this. This one, this flow is only for the in the case of a bar, just for the purpose of a comparison between a bar and a shaft. And the shaft again start with the theta displacement as function of R and Z, and then we simply have a relation shear strain, or we call epsilon Z. Theta is the displacement U theta and Z plus U Z and R theta, and no displacement in Z direction, so this term disappear. But U theta now here is put it there. And then Z derivative, this will disappear, and gamma, shear strain is usually called gamma, right? You may call epsilon Z theta is okay, but usually called gamma. So gamma, you put it here, and you will have a certain Z and R, and then go to shear stress, and gamma is the function of the G. Okay, G. Tau equal G gamma is simply a stiffness definition. And then the torque you apply is the summations of the tau times dA is the force. I'll just consider certain area. This is the dA and torque, I mean the tau. So tau times dA is a force. This is a force, and force times R is the torque, and then integration. So if we put it here, and the result will be like that. Okay, like that. And because of that, we have a tau here. So that's the whole procedures. And this derivation procedures is very similar to in case of a bar. Okay, bar is just a tension and only z directional displacement, which is proportional to z and epsilon z and sigma z. You may call it x, it depending on the coordinate system. And that summation of sigma zz is the p, that is the equilibrium. Okay, so you apply either p or you apply t. Material property we specify either e or g, and deformation condition is that we say at z equal zero, say you z zero or sometimes theta equals zero. So that's the deformation condition, okay? And this procedure will in next chapter, beam theory is always the same. Shaft, bar, and shaft, and beam, all procedures are pretty much similar. So in this case, we will just go through briefly about this and about that, and what is the phi, and this is a u theta. There will be some definition here. Well, this is just again a definition of a shaft. So stress and strain, of course, the deformation will be caused by the torque. Okay, torque or torsion, and the concept of shaft is a one-dimensional structures, and transmit torque is called a shaft. And this torque usually represented by this one, right? Two arrows. And certainly say this is a z coordinate, and moment of z summation will be, let's say, in terms of a force traction or moment traction, this will, let's say, t0, and this will be what? Minus t0, because of opposite directions. And so this t0 minus t0, this is the equilibrium. And in most cases, we fix it, right? We fix it, and say we start with unknown reactions, and say this is the, we don't know. Say we don't know at the very beginning, we don't know. So say TR. So Z directional moment equilibrium will give us T0. Say we don't know even the directions, we just assume positive direction, then TR we call zero. From this simplification, as you can see, TR is minus T0. So as you can see, this will be this way, right? So this is the equilibrium. This is the equilibrium condition to get the reaction force. Now, there could be many different types of a shaft. The solid and hollow, circular, they are all circular. These two shaft is very important in terms of applications. And most of a shaft has the this type of cross sections. And non-circular shaft is like non-circular, could be a square or a rectangular. And another important is the thin wall closed section or thin wall open section. So these the types of a shaft we will cover in this semester. Okay, so that will be covered in chapter 9, but after all review, I will go back to chapter 9. But we are still reviewing, so we will review these two sections. Why this thin wall closed? Closed means there is no open. It's all closed. Starting point and end point is the same. But here, as you can see, starting, and then there is open. Right? Why close? I mean, let's say exactly same geometry. Only difference is the here is very open there. Not much difference, but this will make huge difference in terms of a structural behavior. One very typical example of this one is the airplane wing. Wing, say airfoil type, inside is all empty. You have seen many times outside of a wing, right? But I don't think you have a chance to look inside, but inside is all empty. In most case, there is a two shear wet and sometimes spark cabin and something, but this is all empty. Okay, so this is a very typical case of a thin wall closed section, and these wing structures will support all the pressure from the bottom to up, right, to support whole airplane. So this all the load will cause the bending, certainly is a bending, but at the same time is cause the twisting. Huge twisting. So it's important to know how to analyze this thin wall shaft under bending and under torsions. Bending, of course, we will cover in this semester, and we'll cover the torsion for this thin wall. Well, another point here is that we call cell. Cell means when we have a certain divisions inside, this is the, if we don't have any division inside, it's called one cell. Just closed and one cell, one room. But if we have a certain divisions, and we call multi-cell. So this is the open, but it has a smaller, consists of many multiple cells. And of course, this very thin division will increase shear stiffness a lot. Okay? Again, the reason why we have this kind of a shear web is to increase shear stiffness, very important. Of course, sometimes this skin is a buckle. We increase the buckling load, but shear stiffness will increase a lot. And in structure-wise, this one, we never use this kind of structure, open structures. Why? Because they're so weak under torsions. But it's important to understand the difference. Well, same here. If we have an open structure here, these structures on the top will be very weak. Can I have a one page of a, yes? Yeah. Say this is the structures. Very circular cross section, or can be a non-circular cross section. But as you can see, this is very thin wall structures. And even though it's not very thin, but if it is really, imagine this is a well bonded, okay, well bonded, and try to twist. It's very stiff. See, very stiff. It can resist torsion. It can torsion behavior. But if it is open, when we twist, you can see that it easily twists. The structural behavior wise, it is open, then this will deform like that. Okay, if it is open, it deform like that, but it is not open, it's closed, it is no axial behavior, so it very stiff. So that would explain between we call open versus closed. Okay, we can always go to a theory in detail, but we need to understand overview of the shocks. So as I mentioned, we can have a equilibrium stress and strain displacement, but in these structures, it's better to start with a displacement. Okay, please don't forget, start with displacement. And starting with the displacement would lead to a very important step. It's called finite element method, which you will learn in advanced course. So in finite element method, it will be based on the energy method. We will cover the energy method as well. So all the displacement, we start with this, some displacement assumptions and go through displace energy method and which will give us the approximate solutions. Anyhow, we start with the deformation. So we observe how this shaft will deform. Okay, let's say this is a solid and we have a fictitious plane, A, B, C, D, just a fictitious. And then after deformation, didn't show here, but at the bottom, it has the deformation condition. Remember always the bottom left corner, we have a condition called deformations, and we have a deformation condition like that. And then we apply the torque, or you can say here. And then this ABCD, let's try to observe what happened to these four corners, or this plane enclosed by ABCD. Now, CD is the center of a shaft, and it does not change, does not elongate, does not shrink, it does not move. It's a CD. CD, this line will be, remain the same. And B, since because of this deformation condition, B will be the same, right? Fixed. But the only difference is this A point, and A will move to new position we call A prime. This is the deformation observation. Okay? You can forget everything, but this imagination. You visualize this deformation. That's all you need to have. And then you just go to next step, and next step, next step. But you have to start at this deformation. Now, displacement, any point, okay? Let's say any point within these structures can have R directions and theta directions, well, I can say theta and then Z. So any displacement will have a component U, R, theta, Z. Now U, theta, U, R, zero. It means that when we twist, it does not bulge or does not shrink. It just rotates. So R directional, no R directional displacement, and Z also Z, no Z directional displacement. So which means that when we twist, it does not elongate, does not shrink. Only non-zero component is what? theta directional displacement. Okay, so theta is the only non-zero, and that is what, see again, try to visualize this deformation. See, this is the all what? Theta displacement is proportional to what? This is a z, is increasing. You can visualize any cross sections. Oops. Any cross section is a, you can see this kind of deformations, and this one, okay, so now this displacement is a proportional to what? R coordinate, right? R coordinate, and then also increase along z. You see this one, this increase, right? And here always increase along the r and increase along the along the z and along the r. So you can say that you can visualize this displacement, and in terms of a coordinate is a proportional to r and z. Okay, again, this is all you need to remember. Torsional theory, very important. In case of a shaft, but the shaft is the important one. Now this theta, the proportional C, we don't know yet. But we do know that U theta is proportional to R and Z. Okay, R and Z. Now, here we can say that U theta is a little different view, but the same thing. We'll come up with this. U theta is proportional to R and P. Back to here. Instead of R and Z, we can say this is the angle phi. So phi is a function of z, right? Yeah, how much it rotate? So actually, this is the angle. So exactly the same, but a little different observation. U theta is the R times phi. Phi is the function of z, which we don't know yet. Okay, which we don't know yet. But U theta, we can say the R times the phi. Now phi, as you can see here, is a proportional to z. So what we observed as c times r times z is that we put it this phi into here, we have a c times rz, and u theta, ur and uz is zero. So this is the same observation here. We see that phi is the function of z, which is a proportional to a z coordinate. Okay. Now the point is here. We rewrite these terms again. U theta is r times of phi, and please remember phi is the function of z, and theta. Is c times z is a phi, and this. Now, remember the strain displacement relations, and which was covered in previous sections. In chapter Yeah, we didn't do much about the strain, but where is it? Okay. Here, displacement, introduction to strain. Say we start with a rectangular and we have a deformation like that. And now we have a certain component, strains in terms of a two displacement. And epsilon ij is the ij can be either xy or can be r theta, any component. So that can be a Cartesian coordinate or can be a polar coordinate. In our case, it's a polar coordinate, r theta. So imagine this is r theta. Ij can be xx. Xx means same x, so it's an extensional strain. Can be yy, and yy is will be the same. And xy, xy, yx. That's the result of these strain deformations, strain definitions. And same here. So once we have a displacement, we have a strain displacement relations, and what we have there was help ui x derivative and j and I derivative. So ij can be z theta coordinate, and observe that I j j and j I. So ij j I. So z theta will be theta z z theta. Theta, you have a length, it's r, has to be theta like that, okay? So so gamma is simply shear strain, it's twice of the this definition. And now u theta and u z, put this here and here. And so simply, since we do have this relation, this will z this this appear here, z derivative and z times r. Ah, so what we observe is the gamma shear strain is the z times r. Now, graphically, what does it mean gamma here? Say we can have another fictitious plane here, okay? So we can observe this a volume. And since this one moved to here, the right-hand side will also move to here. So this one and this one, try to have a rectangular and try to have this rectangular. What happened to this one? As you can see here. See, originally just rectangular, but as you can see here, angle has changed. So angle means that this angle, this is the all about shear strain, right? Shear strain, that is the gamma, and gamma is the angle between these after deformation. Gamma is the proportional to r, as you can see here, proportional to r, as you can see here, at the very bottom, no angle, but at the very top is a huge angle. Huge angle here, and angle here, angle is increasing. So gamma, oh, we can see that gamma is increasing along the, it's not like this. We have to say this is the R. Okay, I'm sorry. This one is proportional to R, which means that the center line, okay, center line here, this one is not easy to draw, but this gamma angle change is increasing along the R, okay? Not Z, sorry. Z is the same, as you can see here and there, all same gamma. It's independent of Z, but proportional to R, okay? My suggestions, well, there is a little bit of an equation. You can forget the equations, but don't forget about this geometrical deformation, which you can easily remember. And if you want to remember the equation, what do you do? Ask Google and just find, well, you can say equation, or you can just torsional deformations. You can always find all the theory we just covered, okay? This is the same descriptions, and you can see all the deformations behaviors, as you can see a little different view, but basically all the same story, okay? All the same story, and we will come up with this a polar moment of inertia very soon, again, what you need to observe is these deformations, okay? This deformation and theta displacement is proportional to R and Z and gamma and so on, okay? Again, this is another descriptions. Okay, so this is a strain. What will be the next step? Once you have a strain, what can you have from this strain? Huh? Stress, right? By multiplying the shear stiffness. Okay, so in here, we have these all the shear deformations and strain, and it's important to know that this DFDG, okay? This DFDG is the what about phi is we observe the function of Z, right? And DFDG is the proportional to angle twist. And that is the constant, and this is the unknown, and that will be affected by the shear modulus and the torque we apply. Okay, as you can see here, dz proportional to r. Again, this comes from the u theta and phi times r, and gamma is a derivative u theta with respect to z, and d phi dz is the, you can visualize that phi angle is proportional to z, so it's increasing, linearly increasing like that. So d phi dz is a constant because this angle is, this is a phi, actually phi is the, this one, and this angle will increase proportional to a z, but so this is the simply constant c. And then as a step, tau equal g gamma. Gamma, we now have a term, d phi dz and r, right? D phi dz times r. And tau is simply you multiply g. And the torque you apply now is the, this is the equations of what? This is a stress strain, and this is what? Equilibrium equations. So tau times dA is the force. So you can see that this area is the dA times tau is the force, and then distance r, and then torque, right? But tau here, see, tau is, we know that is proportional to what? R. See, tau is a g gamma, and gamma is a proportional to r, and d phi dz is the coefficient, constant. Okay? So this is the last step you need to remember. And torque, we know that. And tau, we know g, and gamma, but gamma is r, d phi dz. The unknown here is what? D phi dz. D phi dz is unknown. Okay, d phi dz is unknown. And anyhow, we put it back here. And please see, there is r here because of a definition of a torque. You need to multiply distance r. And there is another r, which is the which is in gamma, deformation is proportional to r. So we have a two r here and there, and that's why we r square here, and g is here, and d phi dz. But again, what we observed from the deformation is that d phi dz is what? Constant. D phi dz is a constant. So it can be out of integration, and if material property G is also constant, out of integrations, and G, dpdz is out of integration, or left term is the R square dA. What is this? This is called polar moment of inertia. Very important concept in shocks. It's called IP, or sometimes it's called J, depending on the definitions. So here, what was unknown? Unknown is the, we don't know how much it deformed, but we do know it's a constant, and but we don't know the rate, how much. Now we do know d phi dz is proportional to z, I mean deformation, and now t over g and I, so t over g ip, okay? So d phi dz, simply you can say, DVDZ is the, let's say at the top, at the top we call a angle will be the phi zero. So phi zero is the phi z at z equal L. So phi at L at the top, we call phi zero. That's the angle we observe, right? So dphdz is simply you can call phi zero divided by L. So now the dphdz, now the unknown phi zero at the top, you can see that phi zero is T L G I P. T L G I P. That is the final equations. And gamma, we didn't know dphdz. So dphdz, we know that. So this can be put here. And tau, we didn't know dphdz. Now you can put it here. So tau now shear stress, if we put it this one here, and this will simply T R I P, okay, DP T L G I P. For the solid, so this IP was sometimes called J. It's important to remember this one. In solid, the cross-section radius is R. Then this IP or J is R 4 pi over 2. Remember this IP is the R square dA, right? So let's try to integrate. And R square, what is the dA? dA is this much. So this is a d theta, and this is the R, and this is the dR. So these cross sections is, you can see that R d theta is the this length, and times dr. So we do know that dA is R d theta dr. So integration theta start at 0 to 2i, 2 times of pi, and R is a 0 to R 0. So integrate theta, you can simply times 2 twice of pi, and R power of 3, and so 4 times R 0, 4. So simply you can see that twice pi and R 0, 3, I mean 4, okay, 4. You have to remember this. If there is a hole there, you can integrate R 0, not rather than starting from R, I mean 0, you can start from Ri to R 0. So you simply have this minus, okay? But importantly, there is a force power of the R. See, this is the IE, but this cross section, this is the definition of what? R square dA, but sometimes R dA, sometimes just dA, sometimes R 3 power dA, sometimes R dA, right? Many definitions which represent these cross sections. Well, we are pretty much familiar with this one. What is this? This is simply A, this is the pi R square. Why? Because dA is the R d theta, and we integrate, we get this one, right? But who said we define only this one? No. This cross-section can be represented by this, and represented by this, and represented by this, depending on how, what quantity is required. So for the torsion, we need this. But if we have F times, you know, in case of a bar like that, tension, we do need this. Remember, delta is a how much it deforms. In this case, we have F or P, P, L, E, A. You remember this equation, right? But in torsion, now instead of delta, in torsion, what do you need? You need how much it rotates. So this is the deformation, and here, torque, L, G, I, P. And just compare between these two guys, this is a force we apply, P versus torque, and this is the length, is the same. And modular property we need is the Young's modulus versus the shear modulus. And now this is A, which is needed for the just pure tension, because we need to integrate over the area. But in the torque, we need to integrate R square. And that's why IP. So only difference between bar and shaft is this A and material properties and forces. So you can see quite a similar analogy, and it help us to understand both. Okay? Very important result and observations. And here we have a result. Okay, and always compare to a bar and tension. Okay, tension bar and P and cross-section A, and of course XL and Young's modulus E. Now we have exactly the same, but this one is a torque, and instead of A, we have IP, and instead of material E, we have a G and L. Again, why we need a G? Well, here it deforms in this way. Okay, this way. Here we deform this way. So this is the always a tension, but this one is always a shear. So again, when we twist this way, okay, this way, it scare, as you can see here, it deforms like that. Okay. So again, here is the summary and comparison. For the bar, we have a P, and shaft, we have a T, and A, and IP, and deformation delta is a P, L, E, A, but here is the angle of rotation is the T, L, and G, I, P, and Young's modulus E, and shear modulus. Now, important result is the stress. Stress is simply P over A, no questions. But torsion, pretty much similar, but here is the, see here, we have a tension, and the whole body, as you can see here, okay? And but here, you can see here, and this, and that, and the shear is always goes like that. And the shear stiffness, shear stress, see, P over A, here is the force divided by A. Same concept. Always a stress is force divided by some cross-sectional properties. In this case, cross-sectional property is A, and here is IP. So talk divided by IP is the same concept as this one, okay? But here is simply proportional to R. We need to multiply R. But concept is pretty much the same. Okay. We have several important questions and then tasks I will assign tomorrow. And tomorrow we will have an in-class as well. Okay. We have a bar. See, in the bar, we have a two bar attached together, and then we can apply. And this is the pretty much the same task as your task one, right? And now we could have a very similar problem case, which is similar to this bar. We have a two shaft attached together, and then we apply torque here. We apply a force here. Similarly, we can apply torque here. So this torque will resist by this shaft and this shaft. So these two shafts will deform together, and that is the one. And second case is the there is a consist of a two material, one and second, and there is a two materials, and outside, inside, we have a two different shear modulus. And now, what will be the shafts? Right, this is not the homework, okay? I will go through again and tomorrow. But I just want you to see the analogy between the bar and shaft. And also a parallel and a series connection. This is a series connection. And this is the parallel connections, and result will be pretty much the same. And we can solve many different problems for the shaft, and very similar to a case of a bar. Okay. Okay. So that's all about chapter 8. We spent less than 1.5 hours, we cover all the theory about the shafts. Okay? You should be very happy. Any questions? But chapter 9, after my plan is the, we cover this chapter 8 torsion theory, and tomorrow I will go to a beam theory, okay? Beam theory, well, again, beam theory is the most important, most critical behavior of structures, so I highly emphasize this subject. But the derivation is pretty much the same as the torsion and shafts. And I will go to a beam theory tomorrow. And then there is another chapter, so chapter 11 is for the beam deflections. Okay, beam deflections next week. And then 2 weeks from now, we will go to mainly about this shaft and beam theory as well. This one, thin wall shaft, okay? A very important task. So, when is the midterm? Midterm is pretty much review of all the strength of material one, okay? But of course, the task, there will be another task next week, I mean this week, and which will be due next week. And then we will go to main chapters, torsion and bending and energy method and Buckley. But in this midterm, we will have a individual in-class test. Okay, individual in-class test. Well, homework you as a result of a collaborations. And I really strongly hope that within one group, where some students have a less experience, some students have a more experience, but through collaboration, they reach the same levels and you learn from each other's, which is okay, right? And evaluation will, as I announced, each group will have a same grade in terms of assignment and homework, okay? But midterm and final, you will have an individual test. So I strongly hope that you learn within group. If any member like to know more about the theory and the subject, you can discuss. And it's very important to ask someone or to answer someone. See, through answering is important for those who answer. You can understand better. And important to those who ask questions, we learn new things from those who can answer. Jungangmosa 시험은 각자 볼 거예요. 알았죠? In class로. 그래서 group member끼리 서로 톡 하세요. 그 다음에 모르는 거 있으면 반드시 물어보도록 하세요. 그리고 아는 사람은 설명을 해주고 모르는 사람은 계속 질문을 해서 I hope that even for the midterm and final, we'd reach the same level. Is that fair enough? Okay. Yes. Midterm 날짜가 언제지? 3 weeks from last week of October? The third week of October? 네. 네? 언제부터? 넷째 주. 네. Yeah, fourth week of the October, this October with the midterm. 25, 25th and 26th. Okay, 25, 26일 is a midterm. And again, you know, all your group task and collaboration is to prepare for the midterm. Okay. Yes, you don't, you know, just go through all the tasks which I assign is all you need to prepare the exam, okay? I'm not gonna, you know, go a different direction, or I'm not gonna make it too complicated. So again, it's you learn more through collaboration.
지금 몇 시야? 몇 시까지지?
아, 다 끝났지? Okay. Another one? Okay, so happy and see you tomorrow. Okay.
I'm going to go to the hospital.